Welcome today to today's course, Business Intelligence in Microsoft Dynamics GP 2013. In today's course, we'll cover what it will take to have a successful implementation of business intelligence for Microsoft Dynamics GP 2013. Hi, my name is Brian Meyer, and my team and I are responsible for business intelligence overall strategy for Microsoft Dynamics GP. We're also responsible for core application features, and as well as the business design decisions and strategy for our companion applications. A little bit about myself. I've been with Microsoft for 14 years. And in the 14 years with Microsoft, I had various jobs regarding information worker, information around core features such as manufacturing, sales, purchasing. In the last 7 or 8 years, I've been focused on business intelligence. In the last 7 to 8 years, I've also had 3 patents awarded for designs in business intelligence. And before becoming a member of Microsoft, I was a project manager in the financial industry for 6 years. In today's course, we'll be covering 4 modules. The first module is for SQL Reporting Services reports. Module 2, I'll be covering smart lists and Excel reports. And module 3, Word templates for Microsoft Dynamics GP 2013. And the 4th module, we'll be covering Business Analyzer. To set some expectations for the course, the target audience really for this course is any customer or partner who has either implemented or is looking to have a successful implementation of business intelligence for Microsoft Dynamics GP. Some prerequisites for the course: you have some basic knowledge of Microsoft Dynamics GP functionality, and you have some basic knowledge around SQL Reporting Services, Microsoft Excel, and Microsoft Word. So let's start with Module 1, SQL Reporting Services. In this module, we'll be covering deployment, integration points, modifying existing reports, creating a new report, and finally, we'll finish the module talking about security for reporting services. So let's start with deployment. Switch over to our Microsoft Dynamics GP application. And the first thing you'll notice when I open the application is what's called our home screen. On our home screen, we have a various number of different parts or components within the home screen. The ones that I'll be focusing on today are regarding the charts and KPIs. So we can see we have 2 charts across the top and 1 along the side. So to get these charts, we're using SQL Reporting Services in order to get the information displayed on your home screen. So what I want to start with today is how do you get the deployment to work in order for you to have this implementation to see these charts and KPIs on your home screen. So we'll navigate to our administration tab. In an administration tab under setup, we have a reporting tool setup window. Now in this window, we have various options for deploying our SQL reports and also Excel reports, which we'll cover in a later module. For reporting services, we have 2 different options as far as the SQL Server mode. 1 is native mode, and the 2nd is SharePoint integrated mode. Now, these modes are defined when you're actually installing or configuring reporting services. And so native mode essentially uses Report Manager. And Report Manager for SQL Reporting Services is essentially the application that allows you to manage your reports, add security, and so forth. SharePoint integrated mode leverages the SharePoint module or SharePoint application in order to do the report management and security. In this case, I've chosen to use native mode, which is, again, the default for your configuration for SQL Reporting Services. The next step will be going into to define your report server URL. The report server URL can be found in your reporting tools configuration setup, and most IT people have this handily available. If you don't know where the information is, you can simply go to your start screen and type in reporting, and we've got a configuration services. We see this is our server information. We connect, and under our web service URL, this is the location of our reporting services server. So if you do have some questions as far as where that information is or what the location or path is for that server, you can find it in this window. So going back to the Dynamics GP window, we also have a location or a field to enter our report manager URL. The report manager URL is basically used to go back and determine which reports you have security access to. The report server URL is essentially used by the GP application to call out to that location and extract the reports that you have available in that location. We also have a subfolder field. Now, this would be used if you're using multi-tenant, which would be new in Dynamics GP 2013. So you no longer have to have just a dynamic system database. You can have your databases with different names. And so if you do have a multi-tenant environment and your reports are deployed to a different folder, that's where you put your information for your folder or basically your tenant. The CRM connection integration. So with Microsoft Dynamics GP, we have 12 multi-application reports. And the application reports are pulling information from Dynamics GP and also Microsoft Dynamics CRM. So an example of the report would be looking at sales, future sales. We'd actually be pulling in information for actual sales that have already occurred, and that information would be pulling from the Microsoft Dynamics GP database. And then we can also look at leads or sales that we're expecting in the near future, and that information is combined and pulled in from CRM. So if we are implementing CRM or if we have implemented CRM and we want to use those additional 12 reports, this would be the information you'd use to enter that or to be able to pull those reports back. As we move towards the bottom, we have a deployment status. In this case, we have the two companies that I have set up, Fabricam and Contoso Electronics. And as I expand out, we can see the reports that we have deployed. Again, we'll talk about SRS in this module, and then in the next modules to come, we'll talk about the Excel reports. If you want to redeploy, you simply select the reports or the companies that you want to redeploy for, select redeploy for all selected companies, and then select the deploy reports button. In this case, I've already got these reports deployed, so I'll go ahead and hit cancel. The other area where you can actually deploy your SQL reports are outside of Microsoft Dynamics GP. When you're installing or setting up or configuring the Microsoft Dynamics GP application and going through your Dyn Utilities process, after you go in and set up a company, the next question that the process will ask you is if you want to deploy your SQL reports. In that case, you have the same information as far as which server do you want to connect to and also report manager information, and then you go through that process, but it's in the Dyn Utilities process, so it becomes more of an IT experience rather than in the Dynamics GP application itself. But again, there's two options, one right when you're doing your setup of the application, or if you choose to do it later, you can log into the Microsoft GP application and go to the reporting tool setup window and deploy your reports from there. Okay, so what does this look like? So again, going back to my homepage, now I can see that these are the reports that I have deployed out to my reporting services location. These are fully customizable, so I can modify a report if I choose to do that. I can create my own reports, and or you can choose from one of the over 250 reports that we provide out of the box during your deployment. So let's say I want to go into my homepage and I want to add a different report. So I simply click Customize This Page, go into the Business Analyzer expansion. And now at this point, the GP application is making a call out to the reporting services location that I defined in my setup window. Okay, so now I've got a list back of all the reports that are available for this company and also for me individually. So as I scroll down, let's say I want to just add a quick report showing, could be really anything, I guess, at this point. Let's just say we'll do a total expenses KPI. So I go ahead and insert that. And this may or may not have information depending on the information that's in your database. So we'll go ahead and we'll hit OK to save that. And as we scroll down, we can see now that KPI, the total expenses KPI, has been added right to my home page. So in that case, I can take something that's very personal to me, I can modify this, or again, I can choose to keep what I have or create a new one. So going back into the customization, let's go ahead and show you how to remove that. So if I want to get rid of that KPI again, I just simply go back into the same customization window, select the report I want to remove, and select remove. The other option that I'll point out in this window is the defaults button. So in this case, if I have reports that are defaulted based on my role that I've selected for my homepage, for example, I've selected my accounting manager as my default role or my homepage role. When I come into this window, the customization window, and select my reports, I have two options. I can either go in and select the reports individually, or I can select defaults. And the defaults essentially will take a set number of default reports that we've deemed pertinent or necessary for the account manager role, and default those into your homepage. So you don't have to necessarily go and start from something from scratch and pick and choose what you want. If you want to get up running really quick, it's just a matter of going in and selecting your default reports. Okay, so now let's say I want to go in and I want to make a change to this report. Maybe I just want to change the color. Maybe, just something very simple. So the next thing that I'll point out is the Business Analyzer functionality within the Microsoft Dynamics GP homepage. And I'll cover Business Analyzer in Module 4 in detail. But for this example, I just want to show you some of the functionality that's available with Business Analyzer. So as I hover over, I can see that I've got different actions that I can take regarding this report. In this case, I'm just going to focus on the edit. So we'll go ahead and select edit. And it brings up SQL Server 2012 Report Builder 3.0. So in this case, this is where I go in. This is the application I would use in order to go in and make my edits, and also the application I can use to create my reports. So again, let's just stick with a very simple edit at this point. So if I come in, I want to change one color from green, and let's just say I want to change the color on that. And we'll go fill, and instead of lime green, let's just say we want to go with something yellow or gold. So we'll select that, we'll save the report. We can close Report Builder. And now coming back to Microsoft Dynamics GP, I can simply refresh my home screen, and you can see that report that I've changed has automatically been reflected by just simply refreshing my home screen or my home page. So it's very easy for somebody to go in and make some quick modifications to the report. Again, I could add, remove data if I chose to do that. Or again, in this example, I just did something very simple like changing the color. A little bit later on in this module, we'll talk about how to modify reports in a little more detail, and then also how to create a report. So that's from the home screen. That's one of the areas that we integrate with when we're looking at SQL reporting services. Another area that we integrate with is in the forms themselves. So I'm going to navigate to one of the forms. In this case, I'll just choose our customer maintenance form, and I'll select our first customer. So with reporting services, we really wanted to be able to build the report once, and then be able to leverage it in multiple locations and make it a true reporting tool for Microsoft Dynamics GP. And so as you've seen in the first example from the home page, I brought the charts in, I did a quick modification, and that was easy enough for me to go and make those modifications right on my home page. The other area that we want to share these reports out to or leverage the report is on the forms themselves. And so when you go to most forms, you'll have the option to print out your report writer report or your SQL reporting services report. So we've created an integration to the customer maintenance and as well as other forms. And right off the print button, you'll see there's a little drop-down arrow that's been added in 2013. So in this case, I've already predefined a sales by month or sales per month report that I want to print when I'm on the customer form. So when I print that report, essentially what we do is we take the customer parameter, in this case Aaron Fitt, and we pass that parameter into the report itself. So now in this case, I'm looking at a total sales for the last 4 months by customer, and you can see that this is filtered out by Aaron Fitts. So the way I can change those reports, though, is let's say I created a new report and I want to make that available, or there's another report that I want to make available from this window. So I go to the Assign window, or the Assign Reports window, and as you notice, this looks very similar to the other reports assignment window that we had from the home page. Essentially, we're making a call, the Dynamics GP application is making a call out to the SQL Reporting Services location and bringing back a list of reports that I have available to choose from. So in this case, again, I can choose any report that I have available. The one thing that I'll mention to keep in mind is that the report needs to have a customer ID parameter available to it. So essentially, you have a customer number, or custnum is the technical term for it. That field has to be a parameter on the report, and that's what we pass into the report. So if the customer number field is not shown as a parameter on the report, you won't have the filtering of the report. So let's give it a try and see if this one. So we look at our late shipments. Again, we pass it in. So here's an example of a report that didn't have that customer number parameter on the report, so we're not filtering it. So when you're creating a report, again, just make sure that if you want to use it in the customer maintenance window or item window, whatever the case might be, is that whatever the key field is for that window, that you're also including that as a key or a parameter on your report. And that way, when the report gets opened, the information will be filtered based on the parameter that's being passed in from Microsoft Dynamics GP. Okay, so we've looked at the home page. We've also looked at the integration with forms. And so now let's take a look at integration with the lists. So we'll go to our customer list, and we'll go to our demo list. Okay, so now in this case, I'm gonna turn a few things off here so you can see a little better. We've also incorporated the Business Analyzer functionality right within our navigation list. So in this example, we're using the customer list, and we've got our Business Analyzer, our SQL Reporting Services charts available for that customer list. So as I come into the list, where again, it's similar to what we've done on the forms. As we scroll down and change the customer that we have selected or highlighted, that information is passed over to the SQL reports, and you can see the information pertaining to those reports is changing based on the customer that I'm selecting. Again, this is the same Business Analyzer functionality that's available right within your home page. And so you can see we've got the different actions available. And again, we'll cover that in Module 4 for Business Analyzer. What's also great about this functionality is I can do a comparison. So in this case, if I want to compare Aaron Fitz versus Adam Park, I can simply select both records and choose the information. The reports refresh. And now I can see I've got a comparison between those two companies or those two customers. So it's a very easy way for me to go in and compare one or two or three, whatever the case might be, different customers, items, records, whatever the case might be, and then simply see it visually on my chart without having to go to a chart for one customer and switch to another chart for another customer. The one thing I would caution on this is to be careful of how many parameters that you're actually selecting or how many records that you're selecting, because it just doesn't make sense if I have a customer list of 4,000 customers that I do the select all button at the top and I've got 4,000 very tiny little lines that I can barely recognize what's on the chart. So, you know, do what makes sense when you're implementing or doing presentations, you know, doing what makes sense as far as, you know, limiting the selection to maybe, five or fewer records usually comes out to be a little bit better rather than selecting a whole bunch of data and having a little lines that really don't mean a whole lot. All right, so as we come through, let me show you how we can customize this list. So when the list first opens up, there'll be a default set of reports that are available for that user based on the list. Again, it goes back to we're trying to leverage what we can. We're also trying to make it very easy for users so that they don't have to go in and do a lot of setup and definition when they get started with the modules. They can basically go in, everything is set up for them, and then they can go in and personalize it based on how they choose to do that. So let's show you how you can personalize that. So going into the demo, we can go in, we'll go to, first of all, we'll look at Business Analyzer settings. And we've got different display modes, if I want to reload all my reports or refresh my reports, and then some user settings. Again, we'll get into that in Module 4. So let's say I wanted to go in, I want to customize. So in this case, I could come in and go to my report settings, and now you can see that we've got that very familiar list that shows us the reports that are available to me as an end user in Microsoft Dynamics GP. So I can select any report and make that available right within the report list, right within the customer list, and have it visible right in the Business Analyzer functionality. So the other thing that I'll point out in this functionality is that when you're selecting a report, it goes back to what I said regarding the parameters on the report. So it only really makes sense that you select reports that have a customer parameter in this example, so that when we're filtering through or we're passing the customer ID parameter to the report, that it's filtering based on that customer number. Again, the report would still work if you don't have that customer parameter. It just won't be filtered. So it may be useful to have a report that doesn't filter by customer, but in the example where you want it filtered based on the master record ID, then you would, again, have to have that available on your report itself as a parameter. Okay, so that's taking a look at what we've done here is regards to deployment. So I'll switch back. And one of the things I did want to show in regards to the deployment is that we have a troubleshooting slide that I wanted to point out. And when you're doing your deployment, again, this would be the same example regardless if you're using the deployment from Dyn Utilities or if you're doing your deployment from Microsoft Dynamics GP. When you're doing your deployment, a very common scenario would be you get an error message saying that the max request length has been exceeded. Essentially what happens is when we're doing our report deployment, we deploy the whole module, or basically the whole package. So you have your reports, you have your data sources, your definitions, and so forth. So that gets to be pretty substantial as far as just, you know, deploying a certain information out to your server. So there's some limitations that are set by default in reporting services. And one of those limitations is how big that max request length is. So here's how you take care of that. So basically you go and go to your program files, reporting services, whichever version you're using. I will note that to use reporting services in Microsoft Dynamics GP 2013, that you do need to be using SQL reporting services 2008 R2 or later. So as we go through, we'll navigate to that file, which is just basically a web configuration file. Open the file, and then a few lines down, you'll see that it's going to say something like HTTP runtime execution timeout is equal 9,000. What you want to do is you want to take that line and you want to replace it with what I have in this example here on the screenshot. So once you've done that, basically all you do is you replace that, you save it, and then you rerun your deployment, and that'll take care of that information for you, and your deployment will be successful. I wanted to show also what this deployment looks like. So let's go out to our reporting services server. So once the deployment is complete, essentially how we deploy the reports is by folder structure. So each company and data source will have a different folder structure. So in this case, we have a CES database, we have a data sources, we have multi-company, and we have the models, and a two-company or Fabricam company. So let's see, if I open the CES company, then underneath that company, we have a subset of folders, or basically reports that are categorized by series. So field service, inventory, sales, etc. Once I get into the sales folder, now we can see we've got reports at this level, but then we also have another level of reports or another folder. So essentially the difference between the reports you see on the screen here and then what's in the next folder is that the reports that you see on the screen right here, for example, the accounts due report, these reports were the first reports that we deployed or we made available for Microsoft Dynamics GP. And these reports will be considered more of those analytical type reports. So these reports are not visual, they're very data driven. And basically you select your parameters and you run the report. So these reports were available in Microsoft Dynamics GP version 10. And basically what they were doing is we took the most commonly used reporting service, the most commonly used report writer reports, the top 75 of those reports, and we recreated those or re-architected those reports to make them SQL reporting services reports. So in this case, if I select my parameter and select view, it'll go ahead and launch the report. And in this case, I may or may not have any data available. It looks like in this case, I have a few things available for this report. I'll hide my parameter. And so now we've got the accounts due report. And this, again, this is more of that analytical type report. I did want to touch on it because when you're doing your SQL reporting services deployment, these are also reports that get deployed, but these don't necessarily work very well within the Microsoft Dynamics GP application itself, especially on the home screen, because these reports do require parameters. They're not saved with any default parameters. So usually you'll open these reports up from the report list, and I'll show that in a minute, and then enter your parameter and view the report. Again, if you take the parameters off the report, in this case, the customer ID parameter is the one that it was asking for. If you go in and you're going into the customer maintenance window, for example, you can add the counts due report to the customer maintenance window because we're passing in that customer ID into the report, so that report would work. But there are a few reports that require quite a few parameters. So if you don't have default parameters set for those reports, then basically you just open it and then define your parameters and then run the report. So this is an example of a kind of a non-chart KPI or non-visual report, you know, basically a very data-driven report. So as we go back, let's go back to my folder, and then we have a folder called Charts and KPIs. So the Charts and KPIs folder, this is what Microsoft Dynamics GP is pulling or going out and looking at this location and bringing all those charts in. So I will make mention of this because it is important that if you create a new chart or KPI and you want to make that available on your homepage, for example, that it does need to be in this Charts and KPIs folder. So Microsoft Dynamics GP is specifically looking to the reporting services location that you entered in the setup, and then it's specifically looking for the Charts and KPIs folder and the reports available underneath that folder. So again, if you're creating a chart and or in the past maybe you created a chart and you can't get it to show up to make it available on your homepage, go back and make sure that it's saved under the Charts and KPIs folder, and that's usually the most common mistake that people make. So just make sure it's under the Charts and KPIs folder in the series that you want it to appear in, and then it will show up on your homepage. Going back and just a few other things, we also have this multi-company folder. And with the multi-company folder, again, it's Charts and KPIs, and we have the different series that are available for sale or for the reports that we have. In this case, we'll go to the sales report. And the sales or the multi-company reports are just that, they're multi-company. So for years and years, you know, anytime I did a presentation, a lot of people would ask, you know, the problem was they had multiple companies and they wanted to combine information from those, you know, say three companies into a single report. And we always kind of, you know, push them towards, you know, creating a data warehouse and then be able to report off your data from a data warehouse, because that, at that point, it's combined information. So what we did is we came out with 12 multi-company reports. And the multi-company reports essentially go out to your system database table that defines how many companies you have. And it pulls in or queries information from the companies that you have. So in this case, I've got Fabricam data and Contoso data all within one single report. As I scroll in or navigate into the report, now I can get information for sales information from Contoso for or CES, for example. So it's very easy for me to start with something very visual, something that users can see. Go back to my port here. That users can go in and see information from multiple companies. You launch the report. You can drill back into the report. So again, going back and starting from the beginning here a little bit, I can choose Fabricam, for example. When I select October for Fabricam, now I get the information that's in regards to Fabricam, for example. I can keep drilling into the information. So in this case, I started with something very visual as far as a chart, and now I can get all the way back into the information that makes up the sales for October for Fabricam. So now we get to a level of detail that shows the actual transactions. Now, some reports are modified or a little bit different. Some reports you'll see, they'll have a little plus sign next to the report or next to a record. If they have the little plus sign, that just means that you can expand it out, and then you can see additional information regarding that sales document, for example, or customer. We can also do drill back. So in this case, if I wanted to drill back into the Microsoft Dynamics GP application itself, I select the blue hyperlink field. It opens Dynamics GP to the form. In this case, it would be a document, or let's just move to a customer again. You go back to your customer maintenance form, open the window, and retrieve the information for this particular customer. So again, starting from something very high level, very visual, and getting into the level of detail that we need for, you know, whatever decision making that process that I need to go through. For as far as the SQL report, or excuse me, the multi-company reports, we also have 12 multi-company reports. And again, those reports are pulling information from multiple databases or multiple companies. So very similar to what I talked about with the multi-application reports with Dynamics GP information and CRM information. In this case, we're just pulling information from GP only, but pulling it from multiple companies. Now next, you'll see folders for data models and then also some business analyzer forms or reports out here that we'll talk about in module 4, but this is basically what gets deployed out and the structure it gets deployed to when you're going through your deployment. So now we've finished our deployment, and we'll talk a little bit. I've touched on some integration points, but we'll talk a little bit more about the integration points for reporting services reports. So going back to our application, I'll just give a quick preview or a summary of the integration points as we covered them. One, the first integration point would be your home page. Again, the availability to go in, select the charts or KPIs that you want to make on your, available on your home page by selecting the customized page, selecting expansion, and selecting from a list of charts and KPIs that you have security access to for this company. The other integration again point would be going to our navigation lists and looking at customers and selecting the drop down for the print icon. And again, we get back to if we want to do assign reports, basically pulling up that same list from their SQL reporting services location and making that available. And one thing I will point out in here that I didn't mention the last time is that we have the standard report with the asterisks in it. That is your report writer report. So if you want to make that your default report, you essentially move it to the top. So whatever report is at the top, that's determined to be your default report. So in this case, you can choose to have the dexterity or report writer report print, or you can choose from one of the other two SQL reports. So how that looks is if I selected print, in this case, it would print the dexterity report or report writer report, because that's my default, because that's at the top. And then if I want to choose between that or another report or reports, then that's where I could go in, select my drop-down arrow. So if you always print the same report from this screen, for example, from this window, then just put it at the top layer or top level in the selected reports, and that will become your default. So then basically what happens is when I hit the print button, it'll just run that report. So let's go back and look at our signed reports again. Let's just take sales per month, move that to the top. And now when I select print, it just automatically prints that SQL report rather than my report writer report. So you don't have to necessarily go in and do the drop-down selection each time you want to choose a different report. It's just a matter of going in and selecting it or setting it as your default. And the other integration point is looking at our navigation list. Again, very similar functionality to the homepage in regards to the business analyzer functionality, but an easy way for customers to go in, customize or personalize the information they want to see, the information that is important to them when running their business. They can put that information right in here. So again, we deploy over 250 of these reports that you can use. You can go in, you can modify those reports, so you don't necessarily have to start from scratch each time you want to use one of those reports. You can start with a report that we deployed or that we've created, and then you can modify that. So it's a quicker, it's an easier route to start. Instead of starting from scratch, you basically use one of those reports that we created as an example, modify it, tweak it the way it works for your business, save it, and then make it available in this application. Again, these are the same reports that are available on your homepage, same reports that are available from your forms. So again, going back to the concept that we build a report once and then we leverage it in multiple areas. So you don't have to build a report for your homepage and another report for the navigation list. You basically build one report and then share it amongst different areas within the application. The other area that I wanted to show integration with was actually out on Business Analyzer, but again, I'm not going to go in too much detail about Business Analyzer because I have that in Module 4, but I wanted to show the integration nonetheless. So we have Microsoft Dynamics GP Business Analyzer from our desktop. We'll go ahead and launch that. So now in this case, as I open the application, bring that down a little bit so it's a little easier to see, we've got a similar experience to what we had in our navigation list. So as I scroll through, I can see the different reports that I've selected. I will highlight that top five customer report that we changed the color from green to gold is also reflected in this application. So again, I made a modification to a single report, and then any place where that report is being used or leveraged, that shows up, those changes are reflected in those areas. Again, one report that just reflected or leveraged in multiple locations. So again, this is an area where we go in, and if we want to select our own reports, again, when we come into the application, we get a set of default reports, or we can do a report selection. So again, not getting into too much detail, but essentially, it's the same concept where this application will go. It will call out to the reporting services location that you've defined and bring in a list of reports that you have security access to. And you can see here also that that structure that we have that I showed you out in Report Manager, basically the same structure. So we got our company, we got our series, we got charts and KPIs, and then we got a list of the reports that you can select and make available within the Business Analyzer application on your desktop. Okay, so that touches on the integration points between Microsoft Dynamics GP and SQL Reporting Services. The next thing we'll cover in Module 1 is modifying an existing report. So touched a little bit about on this when we did the modification from within Microsoft Dynamics GP, but let's go into a little more depth about it. So let's take the same report for top five customers, and we'll select our edit action from Business Analyzer. Now, one thing I will point out is that the first time that you select to do the edit, what will happen is it's called a click once deployment. Essentially, what will happen is if you don't have Report Builder installed on your device, that the machine will go out and download it from the internet and bring it right onto your device. So there you will see kind of a setup window that it goes through. It takes maybe 10 or 15 seconds, but there will be a slight delay, and you'll see another window that pops up the first time you select that edit button. Once you have it installed, though, it basically opens the report builder and launches the report. Okay, so now this is our report builder experience. Report builder, you'll want to be using report builder 3.0 or 3.0. And again, for reporting services, you need to use SQL Reporting Services 2008 R2 or later in order for the reports to work with Microsoft Dynamics GP. So if Report Builder is something that, for whatever reason, the click once deployment didn't work or you didn't want to go through that process, basically all you do is you go out to the internet, do a search on SQL Server, SQL Reporting Services, Report Builder 3.0, and that'll take you right to the Microsoft download site. You download it, and away you go. Okay, so let's back up, and I'll show you what that experience is if you're not coming from within Microsoft Dynamics GP. So I've attached this to my start page, and we'll go ahead and run this as the administrator. So again, it's the same experience, but the difference is that if you're launching the Report Builder application natively, that it basically gives you this getting started screen and says, okay, what do you want to do? Do you want to create something new? Do you want to modify, open an existing report, whatever the case might be? Whereas if you're coming from the Business Analyzer functionality, it bypasses the screen and just opens a report for you that you had in context. So you'll see a little bit of a difference between the experience that you have when you first open Report Builder depending on where you're navigating from. Okay, so let's go and we'll just say open. And so this is my server location. So again, this is the same reporting server that I'd entered in Microsoft Dynamics GP in that setup window. When you configure or when you install Report Builder, again, this is the experience if you're downloading it from the web and installing the product itself, then it will prompt you to say it will ask you as far as what is your reporting services location. Again, this would be the same location that you go to that configuration application and draw it from there or be able to pull it from that window. This is also the same location that you're using for SQL Reporting Services within Microsoft Dynamics GP. So all the same server. Again, you're just utilizing or leveraging from different locations. If you want to change your server, so at some point, if you came in and you had bought a brand new server and you want to change it, basically what you do is go into your start at the upper left-hand corner, go into options, and then change your server location. So in this case, if I wanted to switch between different servers, maybe I had reports, financial reports on one server and payroll information on another server or separate server, I can change this and change this based on the information I want to pull in. Okay, so let's just open an existing report. So we'll go ahead and open, and it goes out to the location that I had defined in the application as far as my reporting server location. So it'll come out to that location, and it'll bring back the reports I have available. So again, looking at the same structure that we showed or demonstrated in the report manager, I've got my series folders, my company folders, I should say, and then my series underneath it. If I go to recent sites, I can also see that I had an Azure site that I was using for some reporting services, reports I was working on the other day. And so I can switch between these two different sites just by selecting the recent sites and servers. So again, you have one that's defaulted, but if there's multiple servers that you use commonly, then you can just go to this recent sites and servers and be able to select from them very easily. Okay, so let's just say I want to go into CES. And again, here are my series folders, charts and KPIs. And let's just say I want to take a late shipments report. So let's go ahead and open that. So some of the information I'm covering here will be covered as well when I'm looking at building a new report, but just to kind of give you a flavor of the information that's available in the reports. When you first open the Report Builder application, I will make a note too that this properties information or this properties pane on the right-hand side is hidden by default. And so you'll want to go into your View menu and then turn your properties on. So just a kind of a quick little pointer that'll kind of save you some time in wondering where your properties are. Just make sure you're selecting or turning that on. Okay, so as we go in, we have some built-in fields that are available for the report. So this would be things like page number, execution time of the report, and so forth. So those are just defaulted. Those come in. User ID would be your Windows authenticated user ID. That information is just defaulted in, and you can choose to add those fields to the report or leave them off. So in this case, let's just add a little room here. Okay, so we'll just put it on the top here. So let's just say a built-in field and we want to have execution time. It's just a matter of taking that and bringing it and dragging on the report. So again, if your presenter would have better mouse clicks here and be able to modify his report, it'd be a little easier. But basically you take that execution time and you drag it onto the report and then we'll run the report and see what that looks like. So you have these default reports or default report fields that you can use or you can choose from. The next is your parameters. So in your parameters, this would be where you go in and decide your user date, for example. So another point to make when you're demoing this or when you're first setting up the reports is that the reports are always set by default to use the server date. And so what happens a lot of times is when you go in and set this up initially, you're setting it up against your sample data, and your sample data is set to 4/12/2017 for your date. And so what happens is that your data is at some period in the future, but the report is trying to report on information at the present time. So then what happens is you get these reports that come back and they usually don't have any data because it doesn't match to the dates that are being pulled or used for the report itself. So if you're doing a demonstration, again, if you're in a live environment, that's going to work just fine. But if you're just getting started with this and you want to implement it and use sample data for your demonstration or just for purposes of getting started with reporting services, then you go into your default values. I'm going to kind of start over here, but you go to your user date, you do a right click, and then you do your parameter properties. And under your parameter properties, if there's a list, for example, that's available as a drop-down list of customers or dates, for example, you can do a query based on specific values, or you can add your own values if you choose to do so. And then you can have a default value. So in this case, if I'm doing a demo, most of the time what I do is I just add a value. And I'll just say March 20th of 2017, which matches more along the lines of my sample data. And we'll select Save. So in this case, for this report, for this company, it's going to automatically or default in with the 3/20/2017 date rather than the system date or the current date. The next value that we have in here is a period parameter. And so this will give you an example of the default value. In this case, we have 10 periods that we look at. Basically, a period for this report is a day. So in this case, we're looking at late shipments for the last 10 days. Again, this is a value that's easily changeable. So if I want to just go from 10 to 30, it's just a matter of going in and making modification to 30. The threshold, these are values basically saying that if we have more than five late shipments in this example, if we have more than five late shipments, what we do is we put a red indicator or a red marker on the chart itself. And then we'll change this to 3 because I want to make sure that I don't have any more than 3 late shipments going out in a given day. And then the last parameter we'll look at for this particular report is our chart type. So now in this case, if we go to the available values tab, we can see that we've got two different chart types that we can choose from. One is we can represent our information in a line chart, which has a value of 1, and we can also represent our chart as a column, which has a value of 2. And so if we go to our default values, we can see that the line chart is our default, our value is 1. But again, we can choose to go with a different value if we choose to do so. So now we've changed our parameters. And let's go ahead and run the report. So we'll go back to our home and we'll run the report. Again, I don't have data for this, but you can see now we've got 30 days. So our parameter, our report title, reflects the number of days or periods that we're looking at for this report. So we can see number of shipments for the last 30 days, or late shipments for the last 30 days. And then if we did have late shipments, you'd see them as a column. And when you're running the report, you still have the ability to go in and modify your parameters. Again, this goes into saying where you don't want to have too many days, for example, because it's just going to get a lot of little lines showing up. So we'll go back to 5 and review the report. So again, in this case, I don't have this. Basically, this report showing me for the last 5 days, I don't have any late shipments. So we'll go back to the design view. Images. I don't have any images on this, but you can go in, you can add an image. And I don't think I have a whole lot of images in this case, but I could go in. So if I had an image that I wanted to add, maybe it's a company logo or it's a picture of whatever, basically what I could do is I could go in, add the image right into my report. And the next part we'll look at would be our data sources. Again, we'll talk a little bit more about this when we talk about creation of the reports. But this is basically, in a nutshell, this is where the report information is coming from. So I have a data source that's basically pointing back to my company database in this for this report. And then I have the fields. My data set are basically the fields that I want to make available for this report. So it's pretty straightforward. Again, we'll go through a simple example. You can get as complex as you want to get, but again, for purposes of the presentation today, we'll just stick with something simple.